human development calls for a transformation of self. Each of us exercising our power to effect change through our way of thinking, feelings, lifestyle, consciousness, and actions. Hi there, I'm Audrey Williams. Welcome to today's edition of Jamaica Magazine. Coming up on the pages, we'll look at how the St. Thomas Health Department is empowering citizens to safeguard their health against vector-borne diseases. And later, we'll be saluting national hero Sam Sharp, looking at his contribution to the advancement of free men and women as we approach our emancipation and independence celebrations. Stay tuned for all those and more after these messages.
Jamaica, as we get together and feel all right at the Independence Village Randy Williams Entertainment Center, August 1 to 6. Come enjoy food court, live performances, display, rides, and attractions. Kiddies Village free from noon to 5 p.m. daily with paid night entertainment. Come play a game of domino, bingo, and lots more. See the best of Jamaica's culture and display as we celebrate Jamaica 54. Let's get together and feel all right. Will not
be. A man and his actions that were an instrumental part of the abolition of slavery, the Right Excellent Samuel Sharp, affectionately called Daddy Sharp, is one of Jamaica's national heroes. We celebrate and honor his story in this next feature.
It was Christmas time in 1831, and Samuel Sharp, an educated Creole slave and a deacon at the Burchell Baptist Church in Montego Bay, was fine-tuning the plans for the first sit-down labor strike in Jamaica.
It was a master plan. It was a bold plan. It was way ahead of its time. And it was done in circumstances which were threatening and difficult, because there was no freedom, and because the laws said it was okay for men to be slaves, for people to be slaves. So there's nothing on their side except way over in England, some emancipators, because even their missionaries were telling them, take it easy, don't do anything. Remember, the Bible says, submit to your masters and be quiet and content. You know, so there was nothing on their side except this feeling that this obscenity had to end with their generation and not go any further.
The plan was to have an all-island sit-down strike by slaves at the end of the three-day Christmas holidays between December 25 and December 27. It was the ideal time, as the sugarcane crop would be ready for harvesting by then, and if it wasn't reaped quickly, the crop would spoil. To lose a whole crop of cane spelled certain economic disaster for the island, which depended heavily on sugar as the main income earner. Sam Sharp believed that the planters would be compelled to negotiate freedom and salaries for the slaves returned to work.
What Sam Sharp said, you know, we're going to sit down quietly and we're not working again until they pay us. And somebody asked him, but what if they force us, if they try to force us to work? He says, then you have to make up your mind. Either you're going to fight or what? But there was that down the road if the thing didn't work.
The plan of passive resistance didn't work. On December 27, the Kensington Estate Great House was set on fire. It was felt that several slaves, drunk from the lavish distribution of rum during the merry season, started the fires. The destruction and the terrible loss of lives on that day and ensuing months have gone down in the pages of history as the Christmas Rebellion. Sam Sharp's freedom campaign never turned out the way he planned. He gave himself up to the authorities in a bid to end the slave killings and accepted responsibility for the rebellion, even though a number of actions were taken that did not meet with his approval. He was found guilty of inciting rebellion and administering unlawful oaths.
How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book.
I would rather die upon yonder gallows than live in slavery.
His tremendous courage was seen even to the point of death when he was hanged on the 23rd of May at the age of 31 years.
Is all I ever had. Redemption songs. Redemption songs. Redemption songs.
It doesn't matter that the whole of the legal system said it was okay. And that even some of the churches felt it was all right. As far as they were concerned, it was a violation of humanity and of the compact between man and God, and it had to end. And I think the whole question of how he went about mobilizing the people against this great evil in the face of what was almost certain death if they failed is something that we have to be very, very appreciative of.
Daddy Sharp, as his followers affectionately called him, is now seen as the predecessor of the trade union movement, as he fought for the labor rights of slaves. Sam Sharp's life holds many valuable lessons for Jamaicans today. Although born in poverty, regarded as nothing more than an inanimate object by society, he taught himself to read, argued constructively, and presented himself always as a man of honor. This man of remarkable intellect, courage, and physical and moral authority succeeded in imparting his vision to more than 20,000 slaves in 5 parishes, instilling in them the desire to fight for the freedom so many of us enjoy today. It was his selflessness which propelled Sam Sharp to hero status in 1975. A monument to his self-sacrifice now stands in the heart of Montego Bay in a square named in his honor. Sam Sharp, freedom fighter, martyr, national hero.
Nutritious food, succulent dishes, superior workmanship, and excellent service. Jamaica is on the go. Let's grow what we eat and eat what we grow. Let's harness the indomitable spirit of our most valued resource, our people. Let's support our local businesses. After all, buying Jamaican means building Jamaica. Nugget. Original.
Let's get together and feel all right is the theme for our 2016 Emancipation and Independence celebrations. As Jamaica marks its 54th year of independence and 182 years since emancipation. The use of that theme from Bob Marley's One Love was made possible with permission from the Bob Marley Foundation. At the recent launch, Culture Minister Olivia Grange spoke to the theme's relevance.
This is a call to us and a reminder of one of the key factors in our emancipation and independence, that factor being unity and togetherness, putting our hands and hearts together as we all continue to build Jamaica, Jamaica land we love. The theme also calls us to celebrate and appreciate who we are and our accomplishments. We have proven to the world that we are a nation with talent, a nation that has what it takes to succeed and be prosperous.
So from Sunday, July 31 to Saturday, August 6, the island will be engulfed in a series of events and activities to celebrate our emancipation and independence. These are largely being executed by the Jamaica Cultural Development Commission, JCDC, an agency of the Culture Ministry.
The celebrations this year provides a platform for Jamaicans to feel good about themselves and to feel good about our country. This platform not only provides activities that are celebratory and entertaining, but which also allow for contemplation, dialogue, and commemoration. The JCDC will ensure that all planned events and activities are characterized by our core values, which gives the acronym EPIC. That is excellence, professionalism, integrity, and creativity.
Some of the EPIC events in store.
The Jamaica 54 celebrations will span the length and breadth of the island. and will include church services, parish vigils, flag-raising ceremonies, festival bandwagons or festival roadshows, public forum, street dances, and independence concerts.
Government and private institutions can register their events with the JCDC.
These events will be accredited or endorsed as independence celebrations events and will benefit from promotion through listings on the promotional websites of the Ministry of Culture, Gender, Entertainment and Sport, the JCDC, the JTB, Jamaica Tourist Board, the Jamaica Information Service, and other entities.
Highly anticipated staples will make their return, such as the Emancipation Vigil in Civil St. Anne on July 31. The Independence Village will again be set up at the Ronnie Williams Entertainment Center in Kingston. So too, the Auntie Roach Literary Festival and Mellogaround. And of course, Grand Gala returns to the National Arena on August 6. There will also be a number of new events, including Reggae to Rio, to be celebrated on August 5 as we look forward to our athletes' Olympic success in Rio, Brazil. Leading up to August 6, the major JCDC festival events will take the spotlight.
Welcome to anyone, love tambourine. Rock your body cause you feel like me. How much I love to see Jamaican living in it.
Obusuku Obushle. Good evening, everyone. My name is Monique Patrice Robb, and I proudly represent the parish of St. Mary.
I'm banking in Jesus, Bank of Life,
Bank of Jehovah,
Bank of Christ.
Banking in the Lord and everything is all right.
Number one, just keep banking everything twice.
Wanna catch the spirit yet? Maybe the fashion will bring it alive. This year's theme is Wear It in Gold and Stripe It Bold. The celebratory plans will only come to light due to the support of sponsors like the Chase Fund.
I want to say that we understand the value and we also understand the potential of our cultural heritage to national development, and wisely we allocate resources to achieve these outcomes.
Remember, the celebrations are for everyone, so be sure to take part in the many competitions that have been planned, including window dressing for public and private sector entities, media agencies that best showcase the spirit of independence, advertising agencies that best utilize the independence theme in their promotional campaigns, parish councils with the best decorated towns for independence, the best diaspora celebration, and more. For more details on all these or to register your events for the 2016 Emancipation and Independence celebrations, contact the JCDC at 926-57269 and keep connected with them on Facebook and Twitter at JCDC Jamaica. Let's get together and feel all right.
Every community, every corner, every street, every lane, every nook and cranny, as we'll say, of the island, and of course, those in the diaspora, are expected to come alive and celebrate together as proud Jamaicans.
St. Thomas Ye Vale Anglican Church is celebrating its 177th anniversary with a banquet later today, starting at 5 p.m. It will be held on the church ground on Church Road in Bogwalk, St. Catherine. Guest speaker will be Chief Justice of Jamaica and Chancellor of the Anglican Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, Justice Zale McCalla. All are invited. For more information, call 984-3639. If you are in St. Catherine tonight, the Spanish Town Seventh-day Adventist Church, in association with the Greater Portmore Estate Recreation Department, will be staging the potter, the clay, and the process. A contemporary look at the life of Job. It begins at 7 p.m. at the Spanish Town SDA Church, 7 Brunswick Avenue, Spanish Town. Admission is $500. Proceeds are in aid of equipment for the Community Services Department. The Pembroke Hall Methodist Church will be having its Emancipation Celebration from 7 p.m. on July 31 till daylight on August 1. Dubbed Daylight August Morning, the event will be held at 127.5 Kenhill Drive in Kingston. Activities include domino competitions, storytelling, fashion show, ring games, music, and drumming. It's an evening not to be missed. All Justices of the Peace, JPs, for the Parish of St. Andrew are invited to sign the Magistrate's Roll, located at the Musgrave Medical Complex at 84 Lady Musgrave Road. JPs can sign between the hours of 8:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m., Mondays to Fridays. It's in preparation for the installation ceremony of the Honorable Dr. Patricia Ann Marshall Dunwell as Custos Rotulorum for the Parish of St. Andrew. The installation ceremony will be held at the annual gardens at Hope Gardens on Wednesday, August 8. For further information, contact the Office of the Governor General's Public Relations Unit. Telephone 927-6827 or 550-9460. The Ensom City Gospel Chapel is inviting the community to come out to its health fair on Saturday, August 13. It will be staged from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. There will be HIV testing, free medicals for high school students, counseling services, blood sugar and blood pressure testing, talks on healthcare, bounce about for children, face painting, and much more. See you there! And that's all for our community notices today. Send us your events for broadcast on the GIS Community Notice Board. Call 922-86802 or send an email to cbishop@gis.gov.jm.
This is the Aedes aegypti mosquito that spreads the Zika, chikungunya, and dengue viruses. Search for its breeding sites and destroy them. A message from the Ministry of Health.
We each have a responsibility to protect our health. And one way of doing this is by keeping the environment clean to prevent the spread of diseases or the growth of pests that can spread them. The St. Thomas Health Department has been sharing this message with the community. Take a look.
What are the simplest yet fundamental ways of preventing the spread of diseases? If you're thinking of keeping our environment or surroundings clean and free from garbage and practicing good personal hygiene, you're right.
Whether it is an old tire, it's an unused tank or drum, it's a milk tin, it's a plastic bottle, anything that creates the environment for the breeding of mosquitoes represents a threat. And it's a threat to you, to the public. And therefore, we should see it as our duty and in our own interest to take the necessary steps.
The Ministry of Health's St. Thomas team has taken that national charge and embraced the duty to arm residents with the tools to eliminate the threat of the Aedes aegypti mosquito and the diseases it spreads.
We have been doing our Stop and Wrap program. We do this within the communities to help to mobilize the community really to prevent mosquito breeding. What it involves, we go into the community, you know, stop and talk to people, that's the stop part of it. And wrap, you know, we talk to them about how they can control mosquito breeding on their premises and in the community in general.
But more than talk is happening in these sessions.
Members of the vector control team, they will treat the drums with abates and granules, and we also use our mosquito mesh drum covers. We also demonstrate the use of that. You know, we actually put it on, show them how easy it is. They just need 1 yard of mesh at the hardware, 1/16 mesh, stitching a piece of elastic at the edge of it, and cover the drum. It's easy to use. You take off the cover, put in your container, take out your water, and you cover it back.
The Ministry of Health has identified water storage drums like these as being among the major breeding sites for the Aedes aegypti mosquito in Jamaica. The St. Thomas Public Health team has been helping residents identify ways of using them safely and imparting other related public health messages since the chikungunya outbreak in 2014.
We believe it's working because a lot more persons are aware this time around about Zika virus transmission compared to what was happening with chikungunya.
Yesterday, I'm very elated seeing the part that the ministry has taken to trying to educate we as citizens of this community.
Protect yourself from mosquito bites, and you know how to do that. Wearing long sleeve clothing, wearing a repellent containing DEET.
Another haven for the Aedes aegypti mosquito is old discarded tires. And with schools as the main targets, the St. Thomas Public Health team has come up with a creative project to repurpose these potential breeding sites into containers for fun and beauty.
This is what we call the tire project. We are actually using waste tires, tires that are useless to persons. We're just using it to beautify this school compound right now. Tires are one of the major source of mosquito breeding. So by filling them up and prevent them from getting water, we can decrease the mosquito breeding size.
We have quite a number of designs here. We show the principal and teachers the designs that we have, and they choose what they want.
I love the initiative. It's something that we wanted to do, maybe not with the tires, but we definitely were thinking of putting up a play area, and this just gives us the push start that we needed to kind of get the thing going. It helps to create that decor, and it helps to, the colors helps with creating that environment that they would call developmentally stimulating for the kids. So it is a good mix with what is necessary for them to have in the play area.
This is something we want to continue throughout the parish, and then probably other parishes can adopt it.
And that is what the St. Thomas Public Health team is doing, as they arm residents of the parish with the information to fight dengue, chikungunya, Zika, and all other mosquito-borne diseases.
Up next, top stories making news this week.
Hi there, I'm Simone Wolf with your JIS News of the Week. Prime Minister Andrew Holness announced this week that his administration would be moving to make it illegal for any child to be denied a right to secondary education. He also informed Parliament that all schools that receive public funds would be subject to audit by the Auditor General.
The Auditor General can't audit all the schools, but the Auditor General, I've given the directive through the Minister of Education, should now start to look directly at taking sample audits of schools to ensure that when we are increasing public resources into the education system, that the public can be guaranteed value for money.
Later in the week, the Prime Minister announced plans to launch a national campaign against violence, particularly focused on violence against women and children.
Violence is far too accepted as a currency in social transactions in Jamaica. Violence is far too easy to be used as a means of resolving conflict.
Mr. Holness was speaking at the launch of the UN-funded He for She campaign, which aims to get men and boys to work with women and girls to end gender-based discrimination. And while touring Rainforest Seafoods on Wednesday, the Prime Minister said government would be pursuing measures to increase protection of Jamaica's fishing territory and safeguard the country's territorial waters against poaching.
The economic space that is under Jamaican jurisdiction is 25 times the size of our landmass. And I would be willing to wager that there is significant economic value within that economic zone, which we have not tapped fully.
Government has received a $100 million US dollar loan from the Inter-American Development Bank, the IDB,
to increase access to financing for firms and individuals and to improve the regulation and supervision of the country's financial system.
The structure of the program consists of four components. The first is the macroeconomic stability. The second is strengthening financial sector stability. The third is enhancing financial inclusion of firms and individuals. And the fourth is improving the financial legal framework.
Chinese company Jiuquan Iron and Steel Company Jisco is expected to finalize its acquisition of the Alpart Alumina Refinery in Nain, St. Elizabeth, after signing an interest purchase agreement with current owners UC Rasal in China last week. Mining Minister Mike Henry says the sale should be finalized by November of this year, creating approximately 700 jobs. $220 million will be invested in the first phase of a modification and capacity upgrade of the refinery.
After the modification period, that is the post-December 2017, Jisco would have accomplished critical processing upgrading of relevant equipment, such as digestion, filtration, calcination. This is expected to not only reduce production costs, but also enhance the effectiveness of production.
And building on the Alpart acquisition, Jisco will also be investing over $2 billion to establish an industrial zone in Nain, St. Elizabeth.
Jamaica is acting to extract the maximum benefit and to ensure that this is not an enclave development.
The capacity of the Ear, Nose and Throat ENT department at the Mandeville Regional Hospital has been boosted by this week's donation of clinical equipment to enable emergency and surgical intervention for adults.
We have there five bits of equipment, three suction aspirators and two biopsy forceps, which will be used during the process of what we call rigid esophagoscopy. And I will tell you with no exaggeration that these five bits of equipment are going to save countless lives.
And finally, the public is being reminded that no weapons will be allowed inside the National Stadium for next week's staging of Grand Gala.
Absolutely no weapons, no bottles, no umbrella with long stick and all the other things. The police will be very vigilant in terms of ensuring that they take, you know, cognizance of that to ensure everybody's safety.
The August 6th Cultural Showcase is scheduled to start at 6 p.m. and the gates will open at 3 p.m. And those were some of the stories making news this week. I'm Simone Wolf.
And this is where we take our leave on yet another enlightening edition of Jamaica Magazine. We value your feedback, so keep the link. Tell us what you thought of the show. Send an email to jamaicamagazine@gis.gov.jm. You can also visit our website, gis.gov.jm, or our social media platforms. Until next time, I'm Audrey Williams, reminding you to take care of your health, eat well, exercise, get adequate rest, and make every day a productive one.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.